Well, from the point of view of somebody who did theoretical work in the early 60s, a lot of this is jumping ahead in time, rather. If I go back to the early 60s, there were difficulties in the theory for which we now have solutions, but no coherent theoretical framework for dealing with them. The situation which had developed was that, first of all, when quantum field theory ideas, which had been so successful in electrodynamics, were applied to strong forces, they didn't give good predictions. The agreement between theory and experiment was always very bad. Some people thought that this was simply because the coupling strength in terms of which you make a series expansion was too big for you to be able to do this at all. We now know that we simply had the wrong model of strong interactions. We thought that protons and neutrons and other strongly interacting particles that we observe were elementary, and that meant that the theory that was based on those ideas was almost bound to give the wrong answers. Quarks didn't really arrive as being something with an experimental basis until about 1970, which was several years after the theoretical work that I've been involved in. And in fact, it took several years, I think, for the idea of quarks to be generally accepted, despite the strength of the experimental evidence. Both Weinberg and I remained skeptics for several more years. I'm prepared to admit it. He's embarrassed about it. I was finally convinced in 1974 by the J-Psi discovery. But that was the one kind of difficulty which was not being coped with in the early 60s. The other was that the theory of weak forces was ridiculous. It led to infinite answers that people did not know how to sweep under the carpet. Unlike quantum electrodynamics, by then a number of people had categorized simple quantum field theories of various sorts according to whether they would be renormalizable or not. And the candidate theories for the weak force were simply not renormalizable, and that was a real headache.